Good morning, good morning. I'd like to say good morning to all. We give honor to our Heavenly Father, unto our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, and we give honor to the precious Holy Spirit. This is Minister Reeves again with you for another Sunday school lesson, and we just thank God for the opportunity to be here today. We just thank God for all that He does. Amen. Our Sunday school lesson for today, November the 8th, 2020, our lesson is lesson number 6, and the subject this morning is the love connection. And our scripture today coming from John the 15th chapter, 4th to the 17th verse. I'll read the scripture, and then I will discuss each one as we go along. Amen. Verse 4 says, "Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandment, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandment, and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends, if ye do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, that ye love one another." Amen. Our little lesson context today is John 15. Our lesson is coming out of John 15. So John 15 is at the center of the farewell discourse, which is a series of speeches and a prayer given by Jesus during the Last Supper. Now, generally, this section has material unique to John among the Gospels, and this content make up about 17% of the total text of the book of John. But Jesus builds his case for a mutual love by using common observations from the vineyard. And the vineyard was a staple of agriculture in the ancient world. In the Bible, Noah is the first recorded grape grower, and human society has prized the fruit of the vine ever since. Now, the fruit thereby produced because became a source of sustenance year-round for people. When it was harvested, the grapes were turned into raisins and wine for later consumption, to be consumed later. And one of the enticing descriptions of the promised land was, if you remember, that when they sent the spies to the promised land, not only did they come back and tell them it was a land of milk and honey, but they also had a big cluster of grapes that they brought back, which was a physical sign from the promised land. But vineyards were a common sight throughout Galilee, Samaria, and Judea. Besides today's text, Jesus also used this vineyard imagery in his parable of the workers in the vineyard, the parable of the two sons, the wicked husband, and the barren fig tree. Common experiences regarding vineyards are also assumed in 1 Corinthians. Grapevines would be pruned severely at a certain time of the year, leaving little more than a stump that would be propped up by a rock or two. And all the old branches would be cut off and carried away. They would provide valuable fuel for fires. They would use them in fires. But after new branches had grown, a second pruning would occur to remove the smaller branches. and this allowed the larger branches to produce bigger clusters of larger grapes. And such pruning was part of the process known as dressing the vine. So our lesson picks up today at verse 4, and we'll go ahead and get started. It says, "Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me." Now the same word, same Greek word translated abide is translated many different ways. It's also translated like remain, continue, and dwell. And the same word appears in John 8 chapter 31st verse where Jesus proclaimed, "If ye continue in my word, then ye are my disciples indeed." So the words wide range suggest many ways to stay connected. We cannot abide in the physical body of Jesus. We abide in Jesus when we follow his word, his teachings, as a result of our relationship with him. Now, John's first readers, or the readers that John was writing this to, were little different from us when it comes to connecting with Jesus. They believed that he rose from the dead and he had ascended into heaven, but that happened 50 or 60 years before John wrote this or was writing this text to these readers. But so it was very unlikely that any of them had seen Jesus face to face. Yet John insisted that the command to abide in Christ was also for them. So the vineyard metaphor reassures readers even today that we will see the fruit of our relationship with Jesus when we remain faithful to him. Verse 5, "I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, ye can do nothing." So the vine is the main above ground stalk of the plant. And each grape plant will have one vine, but many branches splitting off it. The vine is the source of water and nutrients that come from the roots to nourish the branches and fruit. So the branches need to stay connected to the vine if they are to live. And we need to, in turn, need to stay connected to Jesus if we want to live. So in the same way, disciples will be intimately connected to Jesus for life-giving spiritual nourishment and leadership. And if this relationship is strong, then the natural result will be the production of fruit. Verse 6, "If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned." Not all branches coming out of the vine are productive or even survive. Some branches are visibly damaged in various ways or even dead. Others simply have no fruit well into the growing season, thus becoming like parasites that suck life-giving water and nutrients from the vine and its roots. So these branches are removed from the vine to allow the remaining branches more room to flourish. And fuel for fires has always been in demand in those days, but those branches seem to be a bonfire just to dispose of trash. And this, my friends, is an image of judgment. To be thrown into the fire is a negative judgment on the faithless and the disobedient. Verse 7, "If ye abide in me and my words in you, ye shall ask what ye will and it shall be done unto you." Jesus begins a more direct description of what it means to abide in him, tying it to having his words abide in a person. This means to have our ways of thinking and our ways of acting guided by the teachings of Jesus. To live in Christ is to live with his commands and teachings as our chief influence. And understanding this helps us know what Jesus meant when he promised that we can ask whatever we will and expect to be done. This is a reference to prayer. This is not some sort of magical formula now praying to find a chest of gold or praying for a big giant house out in the suburbs or things of that nature. But these things would not be in the scope of Jesus' promises. Even asking for good things may go against God's will and thus not to be given. But in all cases, such asking and promise answering is only for those who are deep in the mindset of Jesus. If we are abiding as he asks, we will not ask something that is clearly contrary to the will of God. God blesses, majority of God's blessings are spiritually. That does not mean he can't bless you materially. But Jesus is saying, if you abide in me, then you'll go to the Lord right when you pray. You won't ask for those other things because you are deep rooted in Christ. And furthermore, it might not be in God's will to give you those things. But Jesus saying is that you abide in him, ask the things that you need, ask the things that God will have for you, and God will give you those things. But don't get stupid about it and start asking for all these material things. Some people even go so far to ask God for a husband. What you need to be doing is connecting with Jesus, and then you let God work out things in your life as he desires to bless you. Amen. Verse 8, herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciple. Jesus summed this up in three ways. First is faithful abiding and resulting obedience brings glory to the Father. Our actions reflect on our Lord. Faithful, gracious actions bring God glory. Second, faithful abiding will bear much fruit. This might be evidence of a godly life, what Paul described as the fruit of the Spirit. It also the reproduction of one's life in the creation of new disciples. Now this leads to the third item, in Jesus' summary. Doing this is the core of being a disciple of Christ. A disciple, though now a churchy word, is similar to the English word student. So Jesus is the teacher from whom we learn. He is the teacher that we never outgrow. We are Jesus' disciples for life. Verse 9, as the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. Jesus moved beyond the vineyard analogy to speak more directly about the relationship between his disciples and himself, and among the disciples themselves. He began with the most fundamental dynamic in the universe, which is God's love. Jesus testified to the Father's love for him throughout the book of John. And this love is demonstrated by the authority the Father gave the Son and the Father's revealing his plans to the Son. The Father also loved the Son for his willingness to give his life for sinners. So the love of the Father for the Son has no starting date. This relationship of love for the Son by the Father is eternal. It is therefore an unchanging quality that we can depend on. God's love never changes and it never fails. All these things that describe the Father's incredible love for Jesus describe in turn Jesus' incredible love for his disciples. Yet experiencing that love fully requires believers to commit to Jesus' love. Verse 10, if ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandment and abiding his love. Jesus pushed the connection between command keeping and love abiding beyond his relationship with his disciples to the ultimate parable, his relationship with his Father. Jesus asked him to consider that he always kept his Father's command and never departed from his deep, abiding relationship with his Father. We should remember that in our relationship with God, there is no progression from command keeping to being loved. We are not loved because we are obedient. We are loved because we are God's creatures. We cannot earn God's love. The relationship begins with the eternal love of the Father for us, just as the Father's love for the Son has no beginning or end. We are obedient because we are loved, and we return that love through keeping the Father's commandments. This is how we abide in the Father's love. Verse 11. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. Loving God, and therefore being obedient to him, is not drudgery. It brings joy, a full lifetime of joy. It may seem bizarre for Jesus to be speaking of great joy on the night of the Last Supper because of what lay ahead. And what lay ahead for him was agony in prayer, betrayal, a sense of abandonment, unjust trials, brutal beating, and death by crucifixion. He would truly be the man of sorrows in the hours ahead. But sorrows are temporary, though, and the reward for endurance is eternal. A little later, Jesus promised his disciples that their great sorrow and emotional pain would turn into joy, a situation aided by the coming of the Holy Spirit. And since we're talking about this agony in prayer, let me mention this. When Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane and he asked God, if God, if it's possible, remove this cup from me, but nevertheless, my will, but thy will be done. That was the most desperate prayer ever prayed by the most discerning spirit that ever lived, by the purest heart that ever beat, for deliverance from the most unjust suffering ever known, and all it got from heaven was silent. Heaven was not moved. Jesus was not having a change of heart. Jesus came from heaven to die for man. So I want you to understand that what going on was, Jesus realized that he was about to be separated from God. And that's what broke the heart of the Son of God. It was being separated from God. Jesus had never been separated from God. But he did that for you, and he did that for me. Amen. Verse 12. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. This command is found in many places in the New Testament. In John's gospel, it's first introduced in the 13th chapter. Paul also taught this command for believers in Romans, Thessalonians, Peter did it. But neither of these apostles learned this new commandment by reading John. Instead, the command was learned from Jesus himself, just as John records. Therefore, this command is one of the core elements of being a Christian. A non-Christian may indeed be a loving person, but it's difficult to understand how a Christian could be an unloving person. And we actually have some people like that. Huh? Think about it for a minute. There are some people out there that will speak in tongues, but won't speak and say good morning. But there are many deep issues in the Christian faith, but this is not one of them. When asked whom we must love, Jesus told a story of actively loving your enemies. So if we love our enemies, who then are we entitled not to love? We are supposed to love everybody, because enemies are up here and everybody else in between we're supposed to love. Focus on what Jesus was saying. 13. Greater love had no man than this, that a man lay down his life for a friend. Earlier, Jesus taught that this must be the ultimate sign of discipleship, a demonstration that would mark Christians as different to those outside the fellowship. Now he clarified this love and said it has no limitation. We should love one another, even to the point of dying for one another. This is a tall order indeed. There is a sense here when we consider that John, the author of this book, would be the only disciple present at the Last Supper to die of natural cause. And according to church history and tradition, all the others in the room would give their lives for Jesus and the church. John remembered that Jesus loved the disciple to the end, but they would love him to their ends too. There is no greater love than this. Verse 14. Ye are my friends if ye do whatsoever I command you. Again, Jesus circled back to the expression of our love for him doing his command. When we accept that the Father has great love for us, we will love him in return. We will express our love for him by obedience, not rebellion or apathy, but obedience. And as this love and obey pattern gains strength in our lives, we'll find joy that comes from God. This puts us in a new category because now we become Jesus' friends, motivated out of love to do what God requires of us. Verse 15, henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. A servant ultimately obeys out of fear. A servant could be harshly punished with new impunity, by his owner in the legal system of Jesus' day if they didn't obey. Servants were not confidants to their masters. Their job was to obey without knowledge or comment. And such blind obedience is not what Jesus expects. His disciples are not servants, but friends. They are not acquaintances or business associates. A friend is one for whom a person feels deep affection and demonstrates loyalty. And few servants would ever be considered beloved friends of their masters back in Jesus' day. Jesus disclosed that friendship is the relationship he had been working toward throughout his three-year ministry with the disciples. Their knowledge has grown because of Jesus' many revelations to the nature of the Father and of the plans that he and the Father have for the future. The disciples are insiders, friends, considered worthy of receiving all things Jesus has heard from his Father. Verse 16, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. Jesus also revealed that his relationship with his disciples was all part of his plan. To be ordained in this sense does not mean talking about a ceremony, but having been chosen for a position of responsibility. Now, they were Jesus' friend with purpose, and that purpose is to produce fruit. Your purpose is to produce fruit. My purpose is to produce fruit. This is to be fruit that will remain, a reference not to the grapes, but of making disciples. Remember, it's God's will that we all be saved, that we be like Jesus, that we make disciples, to glorify God, edify church, and evangelize the world. Always remember that. This is why they were chosen. Jesus' multi-generational plan for expanding the number and maturity of his followers. The disciples were reminded that God will give them resources in this work. After Jesus had gone, the Father would continue to be with them, giving what they asked for. These plans and promises are for us also. Still the disciples of Jesus 2 millennia later. If you are a Christian, you are a disciple of Jesus. But we are expected to bring forth fruit. The vine of Jesus continues to produce the fruit of new disciples and spiritual growth even today, and it will do so in the future. Verse 17, these things I command ye, that ye love one another. Jesus ended this section by restating the great command. Within a few hours, the disciples would witness the greatest act of love in history, Jesus' willing sacrificial death for the sin of the world. There is no greater love. There is no expiration date on this directive. It overrides all things that confront us in this Christian life. Jesus' disciples will have disagreements. Conflicts were going to be inevitable. But there is never an excuse for not loving our brothers and sisters in Christ. Abiding, obeying, and loving, these are the central elements of discipleship. The love of Jesus exemplifies all of these. He abides with the Father in a relationship so intimate it is beyond our understanding. He always obeys the Father, and his great love for the Father overflows to his chosen disciple. So in this, we understand what biblical love is all about. It is conditioned by a lasting, faithful relationship and expressed by obedience. It is unselfish love, given without condition or expectation of return. In the Gospel of John, the Last Supper finds Jesus teaching about these things. The arrest, trials, and crucifixion finds Jesus acting out these things. The resurrection shows the Father approving of these things for Jesus, his teachings and his action. Thereby, the disciples of Jesus have been motivated ever since to follow him unselfishly with the purposes of being obedient disciples themselves and producing new disciples in every generation. May God bless you and may God keep you is our prayer.